احمد صلی اللہ رسول الکریم، اما بعد، فاعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم، بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم، رب اشرح لی صدری ویسر لی امری واحلل عقدۃ من لسانی یفقہوا قولی. آئی ویلکم یو آل ٹو ٹوڈیز لیکچر اباؤٹ دا فنڈامنٹل پرنسپلز فرام دا لائف آف پروفیٹ محمد پیس بی اپون ہم. اوکے، سو بیفور وی بگن دا لیکچر آئی ووڈ لائک ٹو سٹیٹ اے کوٹ، اینڈ دیٹ کوٹ از یو ہیو ٹو بیئر دا پین. Either it's the pain of discipline or the pain of regret. So if you're living here in this world, you have to bear the pain. So it's up to you, it's up to me to decide whether we have to bear the pain of regret or we have to bear the pain of discipline. If we are not willing to bear the pain of discipline, then our end is going to be in the pain of regret. Just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala quotes a non-Muslim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala quotes a non-believer in Surah Al-Naba, who is going to say on the day of resurrection, Ya laytani kuntu turaba, that I wish I was a dust. And he wouldn't say, Ya laytani, I wish I was a Muslim. No, but rather that would be the strongest level of regret that is going to be in his heart. That I wish I was a dust. I wish I wouldn't have born. And we as a Muslims, we need to ponder that in this life, if we don't make a direction to our life, if we don't make a discipline of our life, then we are also going to be like the same person who is going to regret. You know, many times when you need to appear in an exam, you are doing party. I want to have fun. I'll do it later. I'll study later. Procrastination. Keep on delaying. Keep on delaying. But on the night when you have your exam, you have regret. Don't you have regret? You have regrets. And the regret is, I wish I would have studied. The same analogy is used in this world. If we don't discipline our life, if we don't work on our lives, if we don't make our life a directionful life, then we are also going to have a regret. And now, Billah, that regret is going to be a very bad regret. It's going to end us in hellfire. The hellfire about the Messenger of Allah said that no person would want to go over there. A person who has spent all his lives in this world in the luxuries is going to forget everything that he was blessed with when he goes to the hellfire. So it's up to you. And the second point why we need to have a framework of leadership is that if you don't make a plan, someone else is going to make a plan for you. So for instance, we know a lot of young blood getting killed in political rallies. Why are they dying? They're dying because someone is exploiting them, because they never had a plan. Without any direction in life, your life is at risk. And when your life is at risk, you might end up somewhere you never wanted to go. You might end up in jail. How you might end up in jail? Because maybe a friend of yours says, okay, let's come, we are going to drift, do car drifting, right? And then he accuses you, you were the driver. You might end up in jail. Okay, you might go to a cafeteria in which illegal activities are being conducted. You might start taking drugs. You never had a plan for your life. If you never had a plan for your life, you might end up somewhere you never wanted to end. Just like a story in Alice in the Wonderland, Alice was wandering around the trees and there were two pathways, path A, path B, a right side and a left side. And the cat was sitting on the tree. Alice asked the cat, do you know which way should I go? The cat replied, Alice, where do you want to go? Alice said, I don't know, where do I want to go? Then the cat said that if you don't know where do you want to go, then you can adopt any way. There's any way you can adopt because you don't know where do you want to go. So similarly in our life, we have started treating ourselves as machines, as animals, just to earn money, have children, eat food, that's all. What is the unique distinguishing factor between us and animals? What's that? What is the unique distinguishing factor between us and animals, Jazib? Salah. Okay? So that means disciplining ourselves, right? Having a connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The framework of Muhammad Rasulullah s.a.w. is the best framework which we can adopt to discipline our lives. It is the best framework. And I'll prove that it is the best framework by giving you several quotations, by giving you several examples. And not only Muslims agree to this, but also the non-Muslims agree to this. His framework was extraordinary framework. Extraordinary in several ways. Extraordinary in several ways. Extraordinary with regards to the goal. Extraordinary with regards to his team. Extraordinary with regards to commitment. Extraordinary with regards to quality. It was an extraordinary goal. And this framework was the best framework. You know about the character of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Sufyan. Who was Abu Sufyan? He became a companion of the Prophet later on. But who was Abu Sufyan? Abu Sufyan radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was one of the staunch enemy of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he accepted Islam nearly on the conquest of Makkah. That was the time he accepted Islam. He was one of the staunch enemy of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when the Rasulullah wrote letters to different kings, when he sent letter to different kings after Treaty of Hudaybiyah, one of the letters he sent was to Heracles. And Heracles was who? King of which area? Of Byzantine. Byzantine was a place where Heracles was a king. And Heracles wanted to inquire about this Prophet of Allah who has invited him towards Islam, to the religion of peace. And he asked for his people to look for someone who belongs to Quraysh, who belongs to Makkah. And people found that Abu Sufyan was in that, within that locality, within that range. And so he called Abu Sufyan and he asked him some of the questions. What were the questions? He asked Abu Sufyan and his people to come, and he asked Abu Sufyan to come forward. So now the people were standing on the back. Abu Sufyan was standing a little forward. And he asked Abu Sufyan, then tell me about this person Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Was he known as a liar in your community before his prophethood? Abu Sufyan, the worst enemy of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because of which one of the reason of his trade caravan was the battle of Badr, right? So the staunch enemy of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what was his reply? He said he was Sadiq and Ameen. We have never known him to be a liar before his claim of prophethood. Heracles asked another question. He asked that what kind of lineage does he have? So Abu Sufyan replied, he has a very good lineage. He belongs to the tribe of Quraysh from Banu Hashim. This is a very good lineage. Heracles asked him, was his forefathers a king? Was there someone a king in his forefathers? So Abu Sufyan replied, no, there was no person. Heracles asked another question, that who are his followers? Are they poor people or are they rich people? What was the reply? They are the poor people. So most of his followers are the poor people. A lot of people like Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu was a slave. So a lot of people were the poor people. Then Heracles asked, is his audience, is the people increasing or decreasing? So he replied, they are increasing. Heracles asked, someone who becomes a Muslim, does he become a murtid? Again, does he become a non-Muslim again? He said, no. Someone who becomes a Muslim stays a Muslim. Then Heracles asked, do you fight with him? And then Abu Sufyan replied, yes. So Heracles asked, who wins? Does he win or does you win? So Abu Sufyan replied, sometimes he wins and sometimes we win. Then Heracles asked another question, and the question was that amongst you, is there anyone who has made a similar claim? And Abu Sufyan said, no. Heracles knew that this is the messenger of Allah. And according to some of the narrations, he wrote a letter to a pope and he asked that whether this person is true or not. And the Prophet replied, yes, this is a messenger of Allah. Heraclius said that I knew a messenger of Allah is going to come. I wish I would have invited him or I would have gone to help him. But unfortunately, Heraclius didn't embrace Islam. The reason he didn't embrace Islam was because he was fearful of his own people. But the framework of Rasulullah, his character was so nice, so amazing, so extraordinary that even the non-Muslims are bound to appreciate it, are bound to acknowledge it. Now, some of the reasons, some of the witnesses, some of the wisdoms behind the answer was, what were the questions? Was he truthful or not? So, Abu Sufyan said he was a truthful. But Abu Sufyan said, no, he's a liar right now. So he said, you better be quiet. I'm not asking for your opinion. I'm asking for the facts. So Heraclius concluded that a person who will start lying, will he start lying with the concept that God is only one? If someone starts lying, will he start lying with the concept that God is only one? Such a big concept. The second question, was his forefathers a king or not? Abu Sufyan said his forefathers were not a king. So Heraclius concluded, if his forefathers were not a king, then why would he claim kingdom? So maybe one of the reasons could be of a false prophet that he wanted to become a king. His forefathers were king and he wanted to get back the kingdom. Another question, is his followers increasing or decreasing?
Increasing.
So that means this is the truth. The religion itself is a truth, otherwise the followers wouldn't have increased. He asked, who wins? You win or they win? So in regards to that, it was a custody, it was a sunnah of the previous prophets that they were never victorious. Sometimes they would also get defeat. So it was a sunnah of previous prophets. He asked, a person who becomes a Muslim, does he go back to a non-Muslim state? Does he go back to Murtad? Does he become Murtad again? Abu Sufyan replied, no, they stay as a Muslim. So that means this religion is a religion of truth. So this was the wisdom which Heraclius concluded from the answers of Abu Sufyan. He also asked Abu Sufyan, tell me, what does he want? Tell me, what does he want? Abu Sufyan replied, he tells us to worship Allah. Allah alone and not to worship anything with him. Subhanallah, the worst enemy of Rasulullah only came with this reason, that he tells us to worship Allah and Allah alone and not to worship anyone else. And to renounce all our ancestors had said. Ancestors have said that, you know, maybe this idol is a god, maybe that idol is a god. He orders us to pray, to speak truth, to be chaste and to keep good relations with kins. So this was the teaching of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this teaching of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is also quoted by a famous historian by the name of Ellis Pond. He said that if greatness of purpose, smallness of means and astonishing result are the criteria of human genius, then who would have been more genius than Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him? Imagine, smartness of means, astonishing result and human genius. If they are the criteria of human genius, then who would have been more genius than Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him? He quotes this, that add regard to the standards which human greatness is measured. All the standards in which human greatness is measured. We may ask, was there any person more great than Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him? Was there anyone more great than Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him? Then why shouldn't we follow his framework? Why shouldn't we follow his framework of leadership? If you analyze your life being extraordinary, what does it mean? Your life being extraordinary, your thinking being extraordinary means that you do something that is extraordinary that a normal person says is abnormal. Someone who says that I want to get all A stars is normal. We all want to get all A stars, good result. But someone who says that I want to get all distinctions, people are going to make fun of him. What kind of person is it? Idealistic person. Someone who says that I am going to do hafs of Quran in 1 month. Are people going to make fun of him or not? They are going to say that how come he is going to finish Quran in 1 month? How come is he going to memorize Quran in 1 month? So there are different stages to human psychology. So human psychology begins with idealism. Jahan Zeb, you were idealist at one time. Maybe you're still idealist. I'll explain you why. You ask a 5-year-old child, do you want to change the world? What is he going to say? You ask a 5-year child, do you want to become prime minister? Maybe not a 5-12-year child. If you were the prime minister of Pakistan, if you were the prime minister of so-and-so country, will he agree that he can become prime minister or not? A lot of people are going to agree. So we were all idealists at one span of time. But then people start to knock us down. You know, our idealism gets destroyed. It gets stumbling blocks on the criticism of people. People are going to say, what kind of funny person is he? Talking abnormality. Idealism is being extraordinary in your thinking and vision. That's idealism. You know, I can do it, I can achieve it, no matter what people say. A 12-year-old child wants to become prime minister. Someone wants to become commander-in-chief. You know, a teacher gives essays to all the children. What is your favorite passion? How do you see yourself when you were like 50 years old? They'll give you tremendous, amazing answers. Idealism. But then the world knocks us down. And you become, what do you become? Optimistic. So first you were idealistic. You wanted to launch a project. You wanted to do HIFs. So for instance, you started HIFs. And people started making you realize that, no, this is not easy. And you know, sometimes you would forget. So you become optimistic that, no, I know I can't do it in 1 month, but still I can do it. You become optimistic. So certain people are optimistic. And then the world drags you down again. People are going to criticize you. You are going to see failures in this world. And you become realistic. And this is not how it goes. Realistic, being realistic is a person says that, you know, first he wanted to be commander-in-chief. Optimistic, I can't be commander-in-chief, but maybe core commander. Realistic, okay, major captain chalega, right? I can either be a major or a captain, realistic approach. Don't try to be, you know, idealistic. Then you become pessimistic. You go to ISSB, they kick you out of the army. Pessimistic, I can't do anything. The next stage of being pessimistic, the next stage to it is cynical. Cynical means someone who says that all the goals are self-interest based. So people are going to say that, you know, only army recruit those people who belong to army or who have links. And then you become indifferent. I don't care whether someone is going in army or someone is not going in army. So gradually with the passage of time, you become realistic, then you become pessimistic, then you become cynical, and then you become indifferent. Subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forbade us from being pessimistic. A pessimistic person commits suicide. I don't love this life anymore. This world is not a place to live. I wanted to commit suicide. They start drugs, alcohols, everything they want to do because they have become pessimistic of life. We don't want anything. And some people, na'uzubillah, become pessimistic of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from their experiences of life. You must have heard a lot of people saying, why is Allah testing me? Have you heard or not? This calamity, why did Allah only choose me for this calamity? Why don't I have so and so facilities which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to other people? This is the approach which people adopt. But if you see from the lifespan, from the lifetime of all the prophets, the famous prophets were Prophet Nuh alayhi salam, then Ayub alayhi salam, Yunus alayhi salam, Ibrahim alayhi salam, Yaqub alayhi salam, Yusuf, Musa, Maryam alayhi salam. She was not a prophet. Isa alayhi salam and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So one task for you is to identify all the trials which Nuh alayhi salam went through. Yalla, be quick. Which trials did Nuh alayhi salam went through? The ark, what was the trial in that? He had to prepare it, people were making fun of him. Right? What are the trial? Nuh alayhi salam, subhanallah, he lost his son. You know, when flood came, he asked his son, to come in the boat, but then he didn't come. So he lost his son. Such a tragedy. Such a trial. Ayub alayhi salam, what was the trial he faced? Ayub alayhi salam got sick, he got ill for a span. It says, some of the narrations say it's from a span of 17 years. For 17 years he was sick, he was ill, he lost his family, he lost his children, he lost everything. Such a big trial on him. Ibrahim alayhi salam. What was the trial on Ibrahim alayhi salam? He had to leave his father. He had to leave his community. They were on idol worshipping. They threw him in the fire. He had to leave. One of the trial was that he had to leave his son and his wife in the desert of Arabia. And he went back. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him to slaughter his own son. And that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grades him in honor in Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Ibrahim alayhi salam himself was an ummah, a nation. The trials which he faced were like those of a nation faces. He was himself a ummah. Yaqub alayhi salam. Yaqub alayhi salam lost his son. Who was his son? He in fact lost two of his sons. Yusuf alayhi salam in the beginning of the story of Surah Yusuf. And then Bilyamin, the second son as well. And not only that, he also lost his sight. Did he lose his sight or not? He lost. And there was no way he could get his sight again. He never knew about it. The trial of Yusuf alayhi salam. Yusuf alayhi salam got away from his family without any reason. Got into the well. The well got sold at a market. Then got trapped. Went to the jail. All the trials of Yusuf alayhi salam. Musa alayhi salam. Musa alayhi salam had to live. Since a child, he had been facing the trials. You know, he couldn't live with his family. His mother had to send him. The people of Pharaoh took him. He was away from his family. He faced trial of he accidentally killed someone and there was no justice being done to him. So he had to run away from that place. Because he knew that there was no justice being done in this land. This was one of his trial. Musa alayhi salam's trial was that he went to the Tur, the cave of Tur, for a certain number of days. His people started doing shirk again. Bani Israel, people of Bani Israel started doing shirk again. They made a cattle god and just started worshipping him again. One of the biggest trials of life. Maryam alayha salam, subhanallah, the trial of Maryam alayha salam. She had to bear birth to Isa alayhi salam without having a husband. Such a big trial. You know, we have become cliche. It has become a cliche since we have started reading these stories from Quran. It has become cliche. Cliche is something that you keep on reading so much that you don't really feel in essence. Subhanallah, look at someone who gets kidnapped. Look at someone who lost his child. Look at someone who have to bear the pain, who has to sacrifice his son. Look at someone whom people would accuse. Isa alayhi salam, people came to murder him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised him alive. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised him alive on the sky. These were all the trials all the prophets faced. And what was the trial of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him? The travel of Taif. Subhanallah, we are going to discuss the incident of Taif, the level, the extraordinary commitment he had for his people. People stoned him. People stoned him to a level that the blood started flowing and an angel came and the angel said that if you wish, if you pray, I would destroy these people. But subhanallah, his extraordinary commitment, his extraordinary generosity, he said that no, I pray for their Islam. This is what he replied. This is being extraordinary. The trial of Rasulullah ﷺ are very much. They are in variety. They are all sort of trials which a person can possibly think. When the Messenger of Allah started preaching Islam, two of his daughters got divorced. Right? The Messenger of Allah lost both his parents. So someone who lost his parents, his father, one of the narrations says that when he was 2 months old, he lost his father. And another narration says that before he got birth, he lost his father. His mother at the age of 6. He lost his uncle. He lost Khadija رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ. He had to go social boycott at the valley for how many years? 3 years. Muslims faced several persecutions. He had to hear all sort of bad criticism, all sort of bad comments. People would say he's a sahir. People would say he's a magician. People would call him by different names. And then he would have to hear all the criticism by the Jews, by the Christians. You know, when there was change in direction of Kaaba, people would make fun of Muslims. What kind of people are they? Sometimes they say that our Qibla is Baitul Muqaddis. Sometimes they say our Qibla is Kaaba. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed a verse in Surah Al-Baqarah that it is not piety that you turn your face towards east or west, but rather the piety is that you believe in Allah. This is the level of piety. And there were several other trials which the Messenger of Allah had to face. Now if I ask you to list down trials which you have in your life, can you list them down? What are the trials of your life? Don't tell me, but just think about the trials of your life. So maybe the trials of your life are limited to 1 to 2. That's all. Maybe someone's parents got divorced. This is the trial of his life. Someone is having cancer. Someone is ill. A trial of his life. Someone is poor. A trial of his life. 2 to 3 trials. The companions asked the Messenger of Allah, O Messenger of Allah, are the prophets being trialed and tested? The Messenger of Allah replied in a Sahih Hadith that the prophets are tested the most. The prophets are those people whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests the most. And then those people who are righteous. And then each one of the person is being tested according to the level of his faith. You know, those people who have great faith are being tested greatly. And those people who have low faith are being tested on a very low level. But imagine, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is testing someone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will also reward him a lot. So all the trials, everything that the messengers, all the prophets went through, did they make them pessimistic? Did they make them pessimistic? We don't want to do this dawah work. People are not listening to us. People criticize them. So being extraordinary in your goal, being extraordinary in your objective means that criticism really doesn't matter to you. Let people say whatever they want to say. So one of the scholars say that if you want to know what is the purity of intention, are you doing this particular work for the cause of Allah or are you doing for show off? Then realize, ask yourself, either the criticism of people is going to affect you or not. If people criticize, are you feeling bad or not? If people praise you, are you feeling good or not? This is one of the litmus tests that you can do on yourself to know the intentions. So if you go back, the prophets were idealistic, the prophets were optimistic. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says in the Quran that do not despair Allah's mercy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that a believer doesn't despair Allah's mercy. He is always hopeful. The prophets never lost their idealism. They never lost their optimistic approach. They never became bitter. Nuh alayhi salam, he propagated for nearly 950 years. His propagation was for how many years? 950 years. If you and me propagate for 2 months, 3 months, 5 years, 10 years, we expect a large number of followings. You know, maybe our Twitter account is going to have 1.5 million followers. Our Facebook account, 23 million followers. This is our expectation from the world. But Nuh alayhi salam, after being propagated, after preaching for 950 years, how many followers did he have? Do you have any idea? They were nearly 60. So 950 years and 60 followers. If you calculate on a yearly basis, it's going to be more or less in decimals. 1 point something or maybe 2. This was the propagation that he did. And the Messenger of Allah said that on the day of judgment, some of the prophets will have 10 followers. Some of the prophets will have more followers. Some of the prophets will have even zero follower. So were they failures in their life? Can you say that they were failures? The propagation of Nuh alayhi salam, don't you think that he was a very worst dai? You think he would have been a bad dai? No. His knowledge was from divine. It was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was the best person to propagate. He would have propagated from all the means, feeling the pain. But he was extraordinary. You know, these things didn't really make him bitter. The Messenger of Allah was extraordinary in all the roles he had to live in. He was extraordinary as a father. He was extraordinary as the Abd of Allah. He was extraordinary in his character. We all have our different roles. So some of you are father, some of you are son, some of you are brother. Maybe you are someone's nephew, someone's niece. We need to have a minimum performance level which we give their rights to. The Messenger of Allah fulfilled everyone's right. Our companions would say that maybe I am the best. One of the companions said that I wanted to know from the Messenger of Allah himself that who is the most beloved to you. And I thought that he is going to take my name, but he kept on taking other names. But check out the level of connection with the Messenger of Allah had with his people. They thought that they were the best. So this is something that they thought. They thought that they were the best. This was the extraordinary goal of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to propagate the message of Tawheed, to propagate the message of truthfulness. And according to one of the narration, we find that the narrator says that I saw a person at the time of Hajj. Now you know that before Islam, the Hajj was there, but the method of Hajj was a different way. So they would claim that they are doing the method of Hajj according to Ibrahim alayhi salam. But we know from the Sunnah, we know from the history, from different narrations, that Kaaba alone had 360 idols, and people would perform Hajj in a very unpious way, in a very immoral way. And at the time of Hajj, the narrator narrates that I saw a man who was going from tent to tent, a man who was going from one place to another place, from one person to another person, and people were pushing him, they were not listening to him. And what was he saying by going to different people, by going from one tent to another tent, was the kalima la ilaha illallah. That you acknowledge, you accept that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is only one. In that staunch heat, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would go from tent to tent, from people to people, and people would push him. And the narrator narrates that his daughter, she came to his father and she asked, "O Messenger of Allah, people are behaving in such a way, in such a manner." And the Messenger of Allah said that, "Don't worry, O my daughter, don't be sad. For verily I know that a time is going to come where Islam is going to enter every house." This was the goal, the extraordinary goal which the Messenger of Allah had for his ummah, for us people. Now if we relate that with our life, what goals do we have for others? What goal do we have for other? Our goal is to take a treat from our friend. This is the maximum goal which we can think of. Now our friend has a lot of money, let's go to cafeteria. Make him spend all the money, this is the goal. But look at the goal of Messenger of Allah. On a corporate level, the goal is to please your boss so that he promotes you to a next level. To please your boss so that he can give you bonuses, to do some corporate politics, to get the politics of power, get the vacuum, get a position. But look at the goal of Rasulullah. Now imagine the goal of Rasulullah, was he vested on any interest? Did he add any personal interest in this goal? No, that was for us people, for this generation. And you know, we find from the history that some of the people from Quraysh came to his uncle and he asked that, "What does Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam wants? Does he want money? We can give him money. Does he want kingdom? We can make him a king. Even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself asked Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that if you want wealth of this dunya, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give him the wealth of this dunya. But subhanallah, what was the reply of Messenger of Allah? That even if they place sun on my right hand and moon on my left hand, I'm not going to give away this message of La ilaha illallah, of this kalima. This was the extraordinary goal of Rasulullah. And in connection to the extraordinary goal of Rasulullah, let me also bring extraordinary commitment of Rasulullah. We people are committed in our own ways, but is our commitment extraordinary? Someone is committed on getting good grades, someone is committed on helping others, but is our commitment extraordinary? No. Sometimes we make a very high plan, but then we sleep. And when we wake up, the plan is sleeping. It is sleeping. Because we are out of that particular feeling. But when we see from the seerah of Rasulullah, his commitment was extraordinary. Extraordinary commitment. How was it extraordinary commitment? He said that if they place sun on my right hand and moon on my left hand. Imagine, sun on the right hand and moon on the left hand. Wallahi, I'm not going to give away the message of propagation of Islam. You know, but for you and me, if we go to our school, if we go to our colleges, and someone is making fun of our beard, someone is making fun of the way we dress, someone is making fun of the way we pray, especially in the Western countries, you know, people, they are very shy and apologetic Muslims. They go to washroom, we just want to go to washroom, right? And doing wuzu. They don't tell that, you know, we are a Muslim, we want to pray. They don't tell it. But subhanallah, the Messenger of Allah, his commitment was extraordinary. How was it extraordinary? Imagine the incident of Taif. Now when he went to Taif, he didn't go on luxury cars. He didn't go on aeroplane. Traveling from Makkah to Taif, even these days is difficult, when you have all the facilities. But he traveled in the desert. His extraordinary commitment in the migration from Makkah to Medina. His extraordinary commitment when people came to him to ask him to stop the propagation of Islam, he said no. He had an extraordinary commitment with the people, with the Ummah, when he himself at the Battle of Trench started digging the trench. The companion would ask, "Oh Messenger of Allah, why do you just leave? We are there to dig the trench." What did the Messenger of Allah said? That no, I also have to dig this trench. So quotation that comes in my mind is that one of the persons said that if you want to excel in this world, excelling this world comes when you are awake at night. So whether it's excelling in IT, you need to do projects at night, late night. You need to, you know, shorten your sleep. Or it's excelling in cricket. Cricketers have to play all the time to get a perfection. Or it's excelling in mathematics, it's excelling in debating, it's excelling in presentation. You need to work hard. You need to be extraordinarily committed to excel in that particular field. But subhanallah, look at the commitment level, the extraordinary commitment level of Rasulullah. That Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha narrates that once the Messenger of Allah asked my permission to pray because it was her time. So he asked Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha that it is more beloved to me that I pray at night. And Rasulullah would pray tahajjud prayer. And the recitation, the span of recitation of his qiyam was so long that it would swell in his feet. Now you all have heard these kind of narrations, but it has nearly become a cliche for you. Imagine a person whose feet got swollen because of the fact that he is standing a lot of time in the qiyam. And one of the companions asked that, "O Messenger of Allah, why are you praying so much?" Didn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised that He has forgiven your past and future sins? Isn't it a promise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The Messenger of Allah said that, why shouldn't I be a grateful slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This was his character. This was the extraordinary commitment he had. This was one of the extraordinary qualities he had. The extraordinary qualities that he had was being truthful. One of the examples of truthfulness that comes in my mind right now is, you know, whenever there's a solar or lunar eclipse, you know what that is? You know what eclipse is? Solar and lunar eclipse. You know, one sun, between sun and earth, moon comes in. And sometimes between moon and earth, sun comes in, right? And one particular day, his son Ibrahim, he passed away. May Allah be pleased to him. He was a child. Ibrahim was a child when he passed away. The Messenger of Allah said that, verily, these eyes have tears. These eyes have tears, and verily the heart is saddened. But the tongue is not going to say anything that is ungrateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that particular moment when Ibrahim passed away, there was one of the eclipses. One of an eclipse. People started to say that this is a miracle. Ibrahim passed away and now there's an eclipse. Had there been any false prophet, he would have said that yes. He would have got an opportunity to prove to the people that this is a miracle. But Messenger of Allah said that no. These eclipses are not because of birth of someone or because of death of someone, but rather verily they are the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is one of an example of his truthfulness. And imagine people are coming to kill you and you have to do migration. But yet you are so thoughtful about their gifts, about the trustees that they have given you for custody. He made Ali رضي الله تعالى عنه lie at his place so that he could return the things, the materials of those people who are planning to kill him. This was the quality of Rasulullah. And not only that, Rasulullah also dwelt in an extraordinary team. According to one of the narration, Rasulullah said, the best of the generation is my generation, and then those who follow them, and then those who follow them. So the best generation is the generation of the companions. The likes of Abu Bakr, Umar, Usman and Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhum. The likes of Khalid bin Walid. The likes of Abu Bayda bin Jarrah. The likes of Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhum. Who do all the things in excellence. Whatever they would do was in excellence. Imagine Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhum was the person who freed Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Who paid the money? Abu Bakr. And who got freed? Bilal. Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu was a slave. Whenever Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu would meet him, he would say that you are one of the people of paradise. Because the Messenger of Allah narrated a narration that I heard the footsteps of Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu in the paradise. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, a leader of his time, a great businessman, freeing a slave and calling him a person from paradise. Imagine the respect he had for other. You know, if we would have been at that time, or let's relate to today's time, you help someone. When you help someone, you always try to, you know, show your authority. That you were a slave, or maybe you were in poverty, I helped you. But imagine Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, his excellence. Now imagine the money from which Masjid Nabawi, the land was purchased. Who paid that money? Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And today all the people, subhanallah, whenever they go to Masjid Nabawi, whenever a jamaat is being conducted, whenever Quran is read in Masjid Nabawi, who gets the sawab of it? Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. This was the level of excellence. And the level of excellence is also told in Hadith of Jibreel. When Jibreel alayhi salam came in the shape of a man, to the Messenger of Allah, and he asked him several questions. One of the questions was that what is Ihsan? What is Islam? What is Iman? And then what is Ihsan? Ihsan, the Messenger of Allah said that you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as you are washing him. For verily you cannot imagine how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. So if you can't do it, then worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as if he is watching you. And this was the level of Ihsan which all the companions had. Once upon a time, Messenger of Allah asked some of his companions certain things, certain acts, and Abu Bakr r.a. was the one who had done all these acts. And it was not only Abu Bakr r.a. about whom we hear different narrations, even about Umar r.a. The Messenger of Allah said that had there been any other prophet after me, it would have been Umar r.a. It's about Usman r.a. about which the Messenger of Allah said that had there been any of my other daughter, I would have also married him to Usman r.a. Now imagine Usman r.a. at different times when there was a drought in Makkah, Medina, he facilitated all the Muslims. These companions, the blessed companions, were the companions about whom the Messenger of Allah made them extraordinary. And according to one of the scholars, he says that that was not an action, but rather the reaction of the companions. So you need to understand this concept, that these companions, it was not their action to be nice to Messenger of Allah, but rather it was their reaction. Now, there's a different thing. For instance, I am the way I am, but I expect all my students to love me. I'm a teacher at school, okay? So I'm really a teacher in school, so I'm not making it up. So for instance, I enter the class, and when I enter the class, I expect all my students to love me, right? And then I would narrate my students, I would compare my students with the students of Imam Malik, Imam Shafi, Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, that you know, they would even wait for hours and hours for their teacher. And my students, what kind of stupid people are they? No one has taught them anything. They don't have any respect. Okay, this is the action which I am expecting from them. I want them to be nice to me. But their reaction is something that determines what they are. If I am not nice to them, if my action towards them is not good, their reaction is also not going to be good. So Messenger of Allah himself, he made an extraordinary team. He was so nice to his companions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that had you been a little harsh, you would have turned them away from you. Had you not been soft, they would have not come in your company. And when different spies from different areas, different kings would see and imagine Muslims, they would say that Muslims are the people from heavens. How are the people from heavens that at night they worship like priests and at day they fight like warriors? Such a great combination. During the time of Tabi'in and Taba Tabi'in, such a great combination that people would say that these people are from heavens. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says in Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah Ahzab, verse number 21, that indeed the Messenger of Allah has been a good example to follow for him who hopes in meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Messenger of Allah is a good example to follow. For whom? For those people who hope to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the last day and remembers Allah often. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself stamps Messenger of Allah that his framework of leadership is the excellent framework of leadership. The life incidences of Messenger of Allah, time doesn't permit us to discuss all of them, but they are numerous, they are several. The level of his extraordinary commitment is shown, is reflected in several places. The level of his extraordinary generosity. Aisha r.a. narrates that when Ramadan would come, he would do charity like wind. So much charity he would do. And the extraordinary care the Messenger of Allah had for us people, us Ummah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that it seems like you are going to harm yourself because of the people who are going away from your message. The extraordinary goal. Now today, in these times, we are living at a crossroad. We are living at a crossroad where there are different people and there is a lot of confusion. Is there any confusion or not? And people are looking for those people who are extraordinary, who are idealistic. Now the discussion which we started the lecture from, let me just conclude that. Why do people try to pull down idealism? You need to understand the psyche. So, uncle wasn't here, but let me explain him. That a person is idealistic. You ask a child, what do you want to become? He's going to say, I'm going to become commander of chief. Okay, chief of army staff. Or maybe I'm going to become president of Pakistan. But gradually, with the passage of time, when he faces failures in life, he becomes optimistic. So he says that, no, I can't become commander in chief, but maybe I'll end up becoming a corps commander or a colonel, right? So, but then he becomes realistic. Going in army, some people get over there, some people don't get over there. Then he becomes pessimistic. Pessimistic is a person who says, I can't go in army. I'm not fit for that. Then he becomes cynical. Cynical is that he thinks that people are motivated of their own interest. So someone whose dad is in army will send him in army. Because my dad isn't in army, I can't go in army. Then you become indifferent. I don't care whether people are going in army or not. Let me just be who I am. Okay. So how do we narrate with this? We narrate with this was that why do people try to pull down those people who are optimistic or and idealistic? You need to understand the psyche. The psyche is they try to pull you down because at one point in life they were also idealistic. Okay. So when you see an idealistic person, when you look at his eyes, he is also reflecting that thing which you were once. So you hate that. Okay? It's a human psyche. So for instance, someone who is getting a lot of business promotions, who is becoming a very successful entrepreneur. And if you also had a plan of becoming a very successful entrepreneur, maybe like, what's the name of the CEO of Alibaba? Jack. Like Jack, okay? Or a very successful military commander. And someone becomes, so you try to pull him down. Not everyone does it, but most of the people try to pull him down. One of the reasons they want to pull him down is because when they look at their eyes, that they remember their past. You know, I also wanted to be like someone like this. And so the experience that they learn from their life, they try to impose that experience on him. You know, this approach is not an idealistic approach. You need to be realistic. But the key point is, if you become optimistic and idealistic all the time, if you don't listen to them, you do what your mind tells you to do, and if you are consistent in them, then gradually with the passage of time, you are going to see that people are going to admire you and they are going to follow you. People are going to follow you. You'll have number of followers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and then so on and so on. People are gradually going to follow you and you're going to also open an avenue for them that this is something possible. If I have done it, then you can also do it. But the problem with us people is that there's a picture that is very common, that there's a big elephant and his leg is chained with a chair. If an elephant can move, then he can break chairs, he can also break a lot of things. But why is he trained like this? Because the chain is not in the feet, the chain is in the mind. His mind is chained. Because once he was a baby, he tried to use some force with that rope. If it's not with a chair, but maybe with a tree. So in that capacity, when he tried to break that rope, he couldn't do it. And he accepted this fact that I am not able going to do it. This is something that I can't do. And gradually, when his capabilities increased, the chain was in his mind. He never tried to break it down. And this is an opposite paradigm of what a Muslim paradigm should be. We should be optimistic, we should be hopeful that we can change the world. And at this time of crossroad, if you don't change the world is going to change you. So like one of the people, some of the people say that if you don't do Dawah, if you don't propagate Islam, Dawah is being done to you. Now, not that Islam is being promoted to you, but you know, if you don't go on right side, you go on the left side. If you don't do acts of righteousness, then you do acts of evil. So someone who doesn't pray, someone who doesn't go to good gatherings, he's going to go in bad gatherings. If you're watching TV, either you convince someone or someone convinces you. For instance, you have a friend who is into bad activities. So if you don't change him, he's going to change you. It's not like that it's going to be static. It's not going to be static. Someone is going to have influence on another person. Like on a very light note, if you don't change your wife changes you. Okay? So either you have an influence on your wife or your wife has an influence on you. Similarly, same is the case with us Muslims. That if we don't make our plans extraordinary, like all the messengers did. And imagine the messengers were also humans. Like it's a very easy concept, but for some people it's very difficult to digest. The messengers would also feel fearful. I'll give you the evidence, okay, before a fatwa comes in. Like Salatul Khawf. What does Salatul Khawf means? A prayer that is being read when a person is in the state of fear. So all the prophets, the messenger of Allah himself have offered Salatul Khawf, right? The companions had offered Salatul Khawf. So sometimes our books make them like a superhumans, but they were the humans. And if they can do it in their limited capacity, of all the companions can do there in their limited capacity, then why can't us Muslims? So there is a reason for us to learn from the lifespan of the Messenger of Allah and all his incidences. That his, if you try to sum up the entire lecture, everything he did was an extraordinary thing. His goals were extraordinary. His worship was extraordinary. His commitment was extraordinary. His thinking was extraordinary. His planning was extraordinary. The planning which he did on the conquest of Makkah, without letting anyone know that Muslims are going to come and are going to take over Makkah. It was an extraordinary planning. Everything which he did was extraordinary. And I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also makes us extraordinary. It's very easy to talk the talk, but it's equally difficult to walk on the talk. But inshallah, with the help of Allah, it's going to happen. We can change the world. Wa akhru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.